The rise in popularity of PVMs and fond memories of the 13-inch RCA CRT TV I bought myself back in high school made me think a lot about how useful small monitors or TVs can be. Recently, I've been very impressed with the little 7-inch LCD that we've used as a DSLR monitor on our custom overhead rig. And this got me thinking about how I want to have a portable display system with an RCA composite input for testing retro gaming consoles and games, and a 1080p capable HDMI input for testing or updating recent gaming consoles and games. Having a multiple format display in a small, stackable, lightweight box is ideal for a million situations. So I sought out information on how I could make the best possible solution for my needs and came up with the Station for HDMI and Composite Testing, now referred to as the shit box. If you're prepared to see what's inside the shit box, how I made the shit box, or even how you can make a shit box of your own, stay tuned for some good shit. Time codes to skip to specific sections of this video, as well as where you can find our tools and gear, is in the description below. I note all of my fails and all of my fixes so you can learn from my mistakes, and if you decide to make your own, you can improve. All right, let's get started. After much deliberation on how I would house my input ports, I decided on picking up this 8-port RCA composite switch from Amazon for $22. I could have picked one up at a local Goodwill for around $5, but I wanted something brand new with a metal frame and with enough space for me to add an HDMI port of my own. I crack it open via the 4 side screws holding the lid on to inspect the operation and PCB design. It's a dual PCB design that has one with the switch buttons and one with the 8 composite inputs and one output. These two PCBs are connected together via 2 ribbon cables. Now, before I get started with removing the PCBs, I need to determine where I would mount an HDMI port. I picked up this 30mm panel mount HDMI and USB pass-through on Amazon for $12, and I already have a 30mm hole saw from my arcade stick modding usages. I decided I'd put the HDMI and USB panel mount on the right side of the switch and the RCA composite plugs on the left. So I marked the size of the 30mm panel mount with a Sharpie, drilled a pilot hole, and drilled the main hole with the 30mm hole saw. After cleaning up the area, I could now test the fit. And I noticed the button switch PCB prevented a flush fit for the panel mount. So after verifying that part of the PCB didn't have any necessary traces on it, I cut an angle off of it with the Dremel. I also Dremeled off a bit of the panel mount's rubber coating with a sanding tool. So here's my first fail of the project. I was trying to figure out where I would route the cords from the HDMI panel mount, and ended up wasting a bunch of time cutting and sanding a hole in the side of the case's lid. I didn't use this at all in the final product, and it won't end up as an eyesore, but it was a waste of time and tools. Now that my HDMI panel mount had a spot on the front, I needed a set of front RCA composites too. So I needed to remove a set from the back of the switch to place on the front. I desoldered the inputs from composites number 7 and 8, which happened to be conveniently located behind where we mounted the HDMI and USB panel mount. I used the multimeter to test what was ground and what was signal on the composite plugs, pulled out the signal pins for one of the rows, and Dremeled and yanked out the composite plugs for that row completely off, since I only needed one set of front-mounted composites. I was then able to line up where those front-mounted composite plugs would go, and I had to trim down the sharp edge on the button switch PCB on this left side as I had to do with the right side. So then I drilled out the holes for the front RCA plugs. And this was my second fail. Instead of using the cheap RCA plugs from the switch, I should have just bought a set of nice panel mount plugs. More on that later. After removing everything, I Dremeled out the metal housing where composite inputs number 7 and 8 were, and I could use that area as a pass-through for the HDMI and USB cables going directly out the back instead of the side that I had previously cut. So I'm fixing fail number one. Then I filed down the hole edges for the front RCA composite plugs. Since they'd exit from the interior, I didn't want someone to slice open a finger plugging in a game console. This isn't something I had to worry about on the right side because it's a panel mount, but yet another reason why I should have got panel mount RCA plugs from the start. And since we're on a roll of fails here, let's make another one. Fail number three, attempting to use a vinyl wrap on the switch. I did a decent job for what would be visible at first, but vinyl doesn't really work well with the buttons and components exiting the switch holes from the inside. No matter how much I use the heat gun or craft knife to precision fix the individual holes, it still looked bad, and although I don't need an absolute perfect amount of presentation value, I just wasn't satisfied with the quality or look. I'll have to fix this in a bit, but for now, I need four total wires to connect the front composite plugs to the PCB switch. I used one black wire for ground, one yellow wire for composite video, and one red and one white wire for audio. Clearly, I didn't like the way the vinyl wrap worked and needed a different solution. Instead, I decided to just spray paint it with a paint and primer, which makes me even more satisfied in my purchase of a metal case instead of a cheap plastic one. Painting plastic would not have been near as easy as this was, and after multiple coats, it turned out very nice. I considered putting a clear coat on it, but didn't end up doing so to avoid a shiny finish. Fail number three has been fixed. Since the input selection box is pretty much done, I need to start to figure out placement and positioning, so it's time for me to put together the box that would hold everything together. It's a $15 IKEA E-Kit. It's a little under 10 inches of depth. You could also use the 13 and 3/4 inch depth version for $20 if your components are bigger than mine. I wanted to minimize desk space, and so this worked wonderfully. Going back to the system selection box, it's time to reassemble everything, starting with gluing the front panel composite set into place and soldering the composite set's pins to the wires that we soldered on that PCB earlier. I did check with a multimeter and verified proper connections were being made before, but did not check to see if male plugs would fit comfortably. More on that later. Now I mount the HDMI and USB panel mounts in with a nut and secure it in place with glue for extra stability and so that it won't rotate. And I pass the wires through the Dremel spot where composites 7 and 8 used to be. Depending on how much glue you put on and how rough you were with the metal box parts, you may have to make minor adjustments and either bend some of the metal back into place or scrape some excess glue away. Now, I like hot glue because it can properly secure what you need, but still be removed later if necessary, which I'm gonna need to do. RGB is in every project nowadays, and I think LEDs would work great in this shitbox. Zero Cool AZ mentioned the particular 10-foot RGB LED strip that he had was of good quality, so I picked one up for $12 on Amazon. I decided to lay them in rows centered around the bottom and top where the monitor would be mounted. Here's an example of how bright it is and what it looks like in somewhat of a low light area before we take the next step. I decided to use a sheet of acrylic to disperse the LEDs and give somewhat of a light box effect. And since I'm a fan of cable management, I could also use the acrylic to separate the power strip and cords in the back behind the switch and the monitor. I marked with a Sharpie where I need to make my cuts on the acrylic. Since I didn't find my clamps in the cluster that is my backup tools, I just improvised by using an additional white tabletop. After lying it on top, I cut a line in the acrylic using a scoring tool and gave it a good snap. Then I repeated the process for the other side of the acrylic. Now Now I needed to disperse the light so that you wouldn't see the individual LEDs on the strip, and thought I'd give both sides of the acrylic a good sanding. I used horizontal, vertical, and circular motions to make sure there was no particular pattern on that acrylic, using both sandpaper and a steel scrubber, hopefully giving it as much of a universal dispersal as possible. After drilling a 30mm hole for wires to pass through from the back to the front, I experimented with using a sheet of paper with the acrylic to see if that helped the light dispersal, since the sanding didn't work as well as I had wished. It didn't help much and ended up blocking out too much light for my preference. I ended up taking my backup route for light dispersal and picked up a can of frosted glass from my local Home Depot. Combined with my sanding, it did the job amazingly well. Assuming I'm almost done with this project, I started putting it all back together for testing before I did any necessary final fixes. The first test was the HDMI pass-through, which I did using the HDMI from the DSLR recording the project, creating a bit of an inception. As you can see, it works. So thumbs up. Speaking of thumbs up, you should hit that like button. The last test was the front panel composite plugs, and now I had finally realized fail number two.
Apparently I'm not done yet, because I hit another fail in the project. I'm coming out of Fry's Electronics with some panel mount RCA jacks.
I believe at some point during gluing the RCAs to the front panel, I got glue into the plugs, or the glue gun or glue melted the plastic form that held the RCA plugs in place. That prevented male RCA jacks from fitting in properly. So I had to desolder the wires for the failed jacks, remove the glue, and then the jacks themselves. Then I mounted the panel mount ones on instead. Since I had already drilled holes in the front meant to fit different size jacks, the new RCA plugs didn't mount properly without a washer, and I had to dig in my supplies and find washers that would fit the new panel mount jacks and didn't allow them to fall through. This also meant I didn't have space for all three RCA jacks, and I'd have to settle for using one audio instead of two audio jacks. This is most disappointing now that I wouldn't have stereo audio and would only have mono audio, but considering this is a test station, it's not too big of a deal. If I had used panel mount plugs from the start, I'd have been able to drill the correct size holes and have all three mounted properly. Now that the new panel mount RCA plugs were in place, I had to solder the video, audio, and ground wires on the back of the plugs. Finally, it's time for some cable management and reassembly. I used some of the IKEA Rabalder cable organizer coils and zip ties to keep cords together, and although it's not super elegant, it's easy to work with, and I used the same type of cable organizer coils around the rest of AZHB Gaming Studio. After putting everything back together, I did one final test and ended up with the finished product. I'll go over what I would have done differently, but first, cue the montage.
I still remember how it used to be, holding hands, running wild and free. Crossed our hearts, said we'd never let go. I still think about our younger days, how we dreamed about a better life. Holding you so close to me, in the backseat of your ride. We fell apart, thought we lost everything, just lost in our memories. I remember you.
Now that the project is complete, it's time for some reflection. If I was making a better one with this experience behind me, what would I do differently? I'd potentially change the size of the box. So everyone's going to have their own specific goals with a project like this. And if you can match the project to fit in your environment, it'll save valuable space. If you wanted to do this with a larger monitor and more inputs, you could. Now, one of the reasons why my project was done in small form factor is I originally wanted it to fit in a IKEA Kallax shelf unit. As of now, the only solid slide-in shelf at IKEA is the Lurvig, which is a cat scratching post. Perhaps later down the road, when I get more woodworking tools, I'll just build a box that fits. And when that time comes, everything can be moved easily. I'll have to score the acrylic again, but that isn't very time consuming. If I wanted more inputs and needed more space, the deeper $20 version of the IKEA E-Kit could be a good choice. Also, the LEDs would probably disperse better if the acrylic was further away. I'd do a better paint job. So I probably should have done 3 or 4 coats of paint on the metal box case, and maybe even added the clear coat finish. So I could always go back, grab some masking tape, and hit the rough spots, but I wouldn't need to do that if I hadn't been so rough with the metal case. So I would have been more sensitive to the Switch's metal case. Dents and warps in the metal sheet could have been avoided by me being more careful when I was drilling and Dremeling. Now, of course, having a fully customizable and stronger project box could have helped too. In fact, I'd use a project box instead of the Switch case. If I had used a project box on my own and then just transplanted a PCB from a cheap RCA switch with less buttons, it would be more functional with less real estate used from a PCB standpoint. Size is of course dependent on how many inputs. You could add components, a network jack, even AC power plugs. Obviously cost becomes a factor there because there's parts, cords, and you're going to need a monitor capable of all your desired inputs. I'm okay with keeping this one simple, but having a version capable of all input types would be amazing. I'd use all panel mount input jacks. Instead of using the plastic RCA jacks that come in the Switch for the front ports, I should have just picked up quality panel mount ones in the first place. I would have made correct drill hole placement, it would have been at the right size, and I would have 3 composites, so I'd have stereo audio instead of mono audio. And if I planned ahead enough, I would probably have the designated yellow, white, red colors for all of them instead of dual red. And I would use hand screws. This would be much more relevant if I were using a project box, but being able to get inside without a screwdriver would be super convenient. Now, if you can drill holes for hand screws in the side and you have the clearance to stick your hand in the box, and it would give easy access to remove the top metal panel or even the entire project case itself, that would be completely ideal. I can put hand screws in the sides in the future on this project if I want, but it's unlikely I'll need to mess with it. I'm keeping it simple as mentioned. I'd potentially upgrade the monitor. HDMI and composite is nice, but upgrading to a larger monitor would be an option, assuming it fits inside your project's dimensions. What I used is small, and the text from a PC input with HDMI is tough to read, even though it does a good job of scaling down the 1080p signal. As mentioned, it would be dope to have a ton of input options, like RGB, VGA, DVI, components. And those would be alongside an HDMI and composite. I think at that point it would be the ultimate shit box. And I'd probably disperse the LEDs more. If I had put another few coats of frosted glass or mounted the LEDs on the side of the box instead of on the back, they'd probably be less noticeable. That's pretty much all I can think of for now. If you think of something that would improve this project, leave it in the comments and we can discuss how viable that would be and what it could be used for. Overall, I'm still super satisfied with this overall project, and it's another tech project completed. I can now take off the list of stuff that needed to get done. We will for sure be using this shitbox in the future with tech projects and review videos, and I'm sure it's going to get heavy use as a testing station once we have the AZHB Gaming Center opened up. And that's it, guys. Thanks for watching. If you liked the video, give it a like. If you disliked the video, give it a like anyway. Hit that subscribe button and consider checking out where to buy the stuff that we used for this project in the links down in the video description. Also down there are social media links where you can follow us on your platform of choice, and consider becoming a monthly patron over at patreon.com/azhpgaming for as low as $2 a month. Every penny of the Patreon funds stay put till it's paying for rent at a gaming center and studio space in sunny Phoenix, Arizona. Every little bit helps towards the goal. Thanks again, guys. Good luck and have fun. Like I remember you. I remember you.